Welcome to Conversations in Care on the Third Planet Network. Today we're talking about a topic that is not only interesting, but I think a lot of fun at the same time. We're talking about type 1 diabetes and ADHD, or attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. That's quite a mouthful. I have a great guest on the show today, Asha Brown, who has type 1 diabetes and ADHD. So let's welcome her to the show. Asha, welcome to Conversations in Care.
Thank you, Tammy. I'm happy to be here. Always a pleasure.
Well, thank you so much. I'm just going to jump into this whole topic of ADHD and type 1 diabetes because it's something you and I have talked about in the past. It is also something that I know my son has both type 1 and ADHD. And I wasn't sure how big of a deal this was until just recently there's a Facebook group that showed up, which is called Shiny and Sweet. And when I saw that, I'm like, oh, there's something to this. So why don't we start with you telling us a little bit about how you got diagnosed with ADHD?
Sure. So I was diagnosed with T1D, type 1 diabetes, when I was 5 years old, newly turned 5. And I didn't really have any issues with that. I was too young to really understand what was going on, you know. And I also kind of, it also didn't seem to faze my parents because my father also has type 1 diabetes and he's had it his whole life as well. So, you know, when I became older, I would say around the age of 12, I started to feel very different than my peers and be frustrated with all the things that come along with managing type 1 diabetes. I was also diagnosed with Hashimoto's hypothyroid issues around that age, maybe a little younger. So I already had these two big diagnoses, and I had to spend every time I met someone new or every year at school explaining about type 1 diabetes. And it was fine. It bothered me, but I got over it and I moved on. But I always felt different. And it was around age, I think, 12 or 13, around the same time where I started to have trouble focusing in class, and I just remember that I spent most of class time drawing pictures on my worksheets, and they were beautiful. I even have some of them. Like, I was an amazing artist, and I found that it actually helped me listen if I was drawing, but it didn't look like I was paying attention, and yes, I missed a lot, you know? So, and I remember a teacher tried to take away my book and my drawing, you know, pencils and stuff because I was doing terrible in math, and I got really mad at them, and I told my parents, and, you know, my parents were like, well, maybe you have ADHD, and I didn't even really know what that was. I mean, it was before it was this common term that everyone said, oh, I have ADHD, I have ADD, but I knew that I did not want another thing wrong with me. I didn't want to deal with a third thing that I'd have to explain to people. And I remember my mom saying, you can take medication and that will help you focus. And I was like, I already take medication. I don't want to take any more medication. So I just didn't want to even accept the idea that I might have it. So around age 14 to 15, my A1C started to dramatically go haywire. And it was because I was also suffering from an eating disorder during that time period. I think along with the high blood sugars, I was so kind of phased out. I wasn't in tune with what was going on. Everything kind of was foggy. I couldn't recognize that I even had ADHD. I think if I hadn't had such high A1Cs, I would have been like, whoa, yeah. I can never calm down, and I can never sit down, and I can't listen to anything, you know, for longer than 5 minutes. That's unfortunate. I really wish if I had addressed it sooner, because I absolutely do have ADHD, I think I would have gotten better grades, and I wouldn't have felt, for all through any school, even up through college, I felt stupid. I felt like there was something wrong with my brain, and I was just dumb and couldn't get it. And it was very hard for my self-esteem, which was also not great because I had an eating disorder. So I really think about the past and just think about how different things might have been if I had accepted and been open to accepting perhaps another diagnosis. And I also wonder if there are other type 1 teens who go through what I went through, you know? So to make a long story short, I did seek treatment for my eating disorder, and it was around that time during the treatment phase that a number of the staff asked me if I had been diagnosed with ADHD, and I was like, no. And at this time when I was saying no, I was like moving my feet, and I was just shaking. And then I'd ask them a question out of the middle of them saying something, and they were like, you need to get tested for ADHD. And I was like, fine. So, you know, some doctor years ago had misdiagnosed me with depression. I obviously wasn't depressed. The Melrose Center where I did seek treatment was wonderful at balancing out my life, being honest with me about what's going on. And so I met with a psychologist through that network who diagnosed me 100% with ADHD. And I, you know, I was in a place at that point where I was willing to accept the truth. Mm-hmm. And I also knew how awful my life had been for the past 10 years, and I really didn't want to live that way anymore. Mm-hmm. So with that, opened up a very bright new chapter in my life, not only with healthy eating and a healthy mind in accepting my diabetes, but also knowing that I do have ADHD and it is okay. It's totally okay. And that I can still be smart and functional. I just have to be honest with myself.
Absolutely. You know, and the only reason that I chuckle as you talked about your diagnosis is that not only does my son have ADHD, but I have ADHD, and my daughter does as well. So we have a whole family unit of ADHD. And, you know, when it was funny when my son was diagnosed, we went in to see the psychologist, and the psychologist sat me down very seriously. She's like, I need to talk to you about something. And she's like, I think your son, I said, has ADHD.
Yep.
Like, yeah, I diagnosed him myself.
Yeah.
But, you know, the only reason I chuckle is because, you know, some of the things that you said, you talked about, are some of the things that, you know, I've seen in myself and my children. So, you know, I don't want you to ever think that my chuckling is, you know, by making fun.
Oh, it's no, not at all. No, I know it's more of a, I've been there too.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, I know once we were able to get my son not only diagnosed with ADHD, but then on the proper medication, everything with managing diabetes on a daily basis became so much better for him. I was wondering if you could maybe talk about that in relation to your life. How did that help with type 1 diabetes?
Sure. You know, it's funny because I was thinking about how to better explain this situation with the topic that you have, and I realized that when I was on the right level of medication, and it took a few months to figure out what medication and what dose would work, and that was difficult, but you know, once you find it, it's like, you know, all systems go. And it's just a part of my brain wasn't able to make logical decisions about what makes sense, you know. Yeah. I was too distracted with this thing and something else, and then I just wouldn't remember what I was trying to do in the first point, which was probably packing a bag of snacks to take with me in case I get low. But now my brain works correctly, you know, the chemistry is balanced, and I found that once I was taking medication for my ADHD, as well as working on practicing good planning and good strategy, you know, types of tools, that I was able to have a lot less stress about my diabetes. And so, you know, in the end, it benefited me so much to kind of be honest with what I was dealing with my ADHD, because, you know, the anxiety of, oh my God, what if I get low? Well, now I have snacks if I'm low. What if I'm high? Well, I brought extra syringes to take a shot if I'm high. And it just, it's all these logical little things that make sense that I had a really hard time putting in place before. The other thing, too, is, you know, maybe you're out all day and you've got a bag or a backpack full of extra supplies and you use it up. Well, before I was on medication, if I used it up, I would forget by the time I got home, you know, to refill my bag. And so now I've got post-its and backpacks and everywhere, and I'll write little notes that I can just keep with me, and I just stick them on the counter as soon as I get home, and they're just things to make sure I've got all of my diabetes tools that I need for the next day. So it's a huge difference.
You know what, it was a huge difference for my son as well. You know, you know, the concept of being able to, you know, I'd find the poker in one part of the room, the meter in another part, the strip someplace else.
Right.
Together.
right. And I don't know why we, what were we thinking when we walked into the other room? We just keep setting things all over the place.
But, you know, and I think maybe here might be a good place too, because you kind of mentioned your, how you have Post-its, and I think you have this really, this great system, and I'd like to talk about that kind of in conjunction with medication. And maybe we should jump into the medication piece first, because, you know, I think medication is an important topic. It may not be right for everyone, but I think it is right for a lot of people. And maybe you can tell us about, you know, when used correctly, or, you know, right dosages and things of that nature.
Yeah, you know, I know almost anyone who is, like, alive and with it in this day and age has heard that, you know, college students will abuse Adderall, that Adderall is a street drug, and they hear of stories of where women, you know, who want to lose weight try to get Adderall prescriptions from their doctors, and there's all this kind of stuff, and that sucks because it really does cheapen the people that really do need it and that have absolutely had a much better life existence when they're treated with Adderall or whatever. You know, there's Ritalin, there's a huge array of medications, there's extended release and instant release, and it's just unfortunate how our culture abuses things, you know. So there's my little rant, but I want to say too is that I am a performer. I have been performing since I was 5, and you know, many of my peers, even in my early 20s, would say, well, I was diagnosed with ADHD, but I don't want to take the medication because it gets rid of my creativity. I'm just too boring, and I don't have, like, really creative thoughts. And I was like, oh, that sounds terrible. And I do think, from what I've understood now by talking to other people, that, you know, if you're taking too much of a medication, or if you're just not getting the right dosage, you and the doctor haven't communicated effectively, then yes, there could be a zombie-like state. But any ADHD medication is absolutely not meant to change your personality, not at all. Mm-hmm. It's meant to give you a subtle change in how your brain chemistry works and how you focus on your day. It's not meant to change your life, and it's not meant to change who you are. And, you know, my doctor was really good at explaining that to me, and so we took it very slow, and she's also still open to, if something chemical-wise in me changes, to changing it. It's not just, this is the only dose you take for the rest of your life, because our bodies and our body chemistry changes with time. Yeah.
You know, and there's another thing that you had said, I don't know if it was when we were talking one time, but also that the medication, or maybe you even mentioned it earlier, that the medication isn't the thing that's going to totally fix ADHD.
Yes, absolutely. No, that's a really good point. You know, it's no pill is going to change your life. And I mean, really, if you think about it, you don't just take insulin and be a great diabetic or be cured from diabetes. You still have type 1 diabetes, and along with that, you know, the insulin dosage varies every day, every meal. So with that being said, it is absolutely helpful to be on medication if you really do have ADHD or ADD. But it isn't going to fix all of your problems. And if you only rely on medication to keep your focus, then you may have a good little window of time where you can get things done, but then the rest of your day, you know, when a medication wears off, and you can't be medicated 24 hours a day because it's just not healthy.
Right.
You never sleep. But one cannot rely only on medication for fixes. You have to start taking some personal action. So I have gotten really good about having notepads and Post-its and pens in every room. I think what I shared last time is we moved this summer, and it was really a horrible experience for me. It was just, I don't like change. I don't like my stuff being in boxes. I thrive on an organized environment now, so that was just really hard. But what I did as we started to unpack is, you know, I was just like, oh my God, this is just crazy. So I just left Post-its in every room. I'd write, like, go get this from the box downstairs, and I just would put them on my chest. I had a black sweatshirt on, so they stuck really well. And then every trip made to the kitchen, I just put them all down just so I had them, you know. And so that is a great example of, you know, the medication could only do so much for me that day. It was an overwhelming day, and I had to be on the ball to work with what I knew I would need help with. And with that, it was remembering all the things I needed to find so I could go to work today with clothes on, you know. So I really encourage anyone who does take medication for ADHD to know that you have the power to research time management skills. You have the power to find any method that works for you, you know, a structured plan of how you come home, how you unpack your day and get ready for the next day. That's all up to what works for the individual.
You know, and I think those are great points. I remember one of the things that I've learned, because I was diagnosed probably, I don't know, maybe by over 15 years ago.
Yeah, wow.
But I, you know, each year I learn something new about myself. You know, I'm better in the morning, so I want to do some of those really tough tasks in the morning. You know, as it gets later in the day, forget it. So I'm learning some of those things. And one of the other things that I have probably the world's best friend ever. And when I had to move years ago, she pretty much took over, like, all that organizing stuff, okay? Everything that's in this box is for the kitchen, you know, and I just pretty much was the person lifting and moving and just and taking that direction from her, because I could not, at that time, there was some emotional stuff going on with that as well, but I could not handle that.
Yep.
So, you know, if her and I do anything together, she knows what she can do and what I can do.
I love that. I love that so much. And, you know, I even tell my husband, you know, I say, we have until 7 o'clock to do this work on our website. And after that, I cannot guarantee that I will pay attention to you or that I will remember what you say.
Right.
So if there are important things that you need to say, you should tell me now. I know you want to go play a game. This is just how it's got to work. And he told, and I say, you want to watch a movie? We've got to start before 7, or I will be getting up every half an hour. I'll be on my phone. I'll be texting, you know, and we do have to be very honest with ourselves. And, I, you know, I relate to what you said, too, is that I know, you know, the best few hours of the day when I have taken my medication, that's the best time to get to the difficult tasks, whether it be coordinating a really confusing email or, you know, making plans of some sort that take a lot of brain power. There's no reason to wait. When you know that your body is in the zone, then it's the best time to tackle those tasks.
Absolutely, absolutely. I agree with that. Now, one of the things that I also wanted to kind of try to tackle in our conversation today is that on the Facebook group, Shiny and Sweet, we had posted a question to everybody if they had any questions about this topic, that we would try to kind of go over those. And there were two questions, and the first one was shared with us by a woman named Shauna. And she asked that when the ADHD medications wear off on her son, he becomes very impulsive and wants to start eating and sneaking treats. And I was wondering if you might be able to help address that concept.
Sure. You know, I don't think it's a secret that these stimulant drugs, because our body does need that stimulant in the medication, they can cause a little bit of an appetite kill for the day, especially in growing kids. And, you know, I know that, you know, some parents also then have the concern of even giving those medications to their child, but any parent who has a child with true ADHD, they're going to give them the medication because it's the best choice for everyone involved. But, yes, so there is a time, you know, when the medication wears off where someone can be craving sugar or sweets, or, you know, it's just kind of a kids want to have really good meaning junky snacks, and if their medication is worn off, they will be very impulsive and try to get it no matter what. So I noticed this in myself, that there was a shift in my appetite and kind of what I was thinking about after my medication wore off, and I noticed that I craved a lot of carbohydrates in the evening. And I don't think that no one should deny themselves to eat a food they enjoy, but I think there's very smart ways to enjoy what we're eating, have it be tasty, but also have it be diabetes friendly. And it was around that time that I started, I don't like cooking, I don't like baking. It doesn't bring me joy, it doesn't make me happy. To me, it's a task to get done. But I did open up my eyes and start researching some lower carb recipes for, you know, healthy bars, muffins, even pies, all sorts of stuff. And I had been recently diagnosed with gluten intolerance at Melrose as well. So I was looking for that component, and I found a huge offering of recipes that have very little carbohydrate content but are tasty. The best thing about them is that they're very healthy because they have nutrition and protein and fiber in them as well. So I started to just make that, you know, 4:30 or 5 p.m. was my time to have those delicious treats. Even one or two would not ruin my blood sugars whatsoever. It was a great, you know, snack before my husband came home and I made dinner. And, you know, kids, they're going to want tasty, treat-like things, and there's nothing wrong with that. And I think that for a family dealing with a type 1 diabetic child, it's a great way to offer them to show you can have treats, but let's eat these treats that we made last weekend that are really good on your blood sugars and that, you know, kind of give you that craving satisfaction.
Absolutely. You know, my son is 15. He's growing like a weed. And pretty much as soon as he hits the door at 3 o'clock, I mean, that's when the eating begins and it doesn't end until...
Right. And, you know, baking and, you know, doing stuff, I like to bake in bulk. I pick one weekend every month and I'm like, I'm just going to do it. And I make a couple different batches of stuff. Sometimes I'll double the recipe and I'll put a bunch of it in my freezer and then defrost as needed. All, you know, I'm sharing a few recipes with you that I know that you're going to, you know, share with the community. Absolutely. And all of those are freezer friendly. You just defrost them. They still taste delicious. And for me, that just, it's worth it getting it done on a weekend, and then I've got lots of good, healthy choices that taste good, so I don't feel like I'm depriving myself, and I do get the carbohydrate satisfaction from it as well.
You know, and I like that idea, and now that you said the freezing, you know, because I'm like you, the cooking, the baking, is just another chore, but if I were to be able to take one weekend, and that's all I did,
right. You know, and, you know, that's a good thing to include. If this is about, you know, a child who wants to have baked treats, include them and you know, let them learn how to do it so that that becomes a habit that they keep on in their lives. I mean, type 1 diabetics always do have to be conscious of food and what they're putting in their body, if only to be able to bolus correctly. Mm-hmm. But it's a great habit to get used to make your own tasty snacks. And it will help them learn how to stock their own freezer someday, hopefully.
No, and that's what I like about it because, you know, I definitely my son's at the point where I can mold him.
Right.
At least that's my goal, is to mold him a little bit.
Time has not run out.
So I will definitely make sure I have those recipes. I will make sure that they're not only in that Facebook forum, but then on my website and also in the newsletter that goes out to everyone. And then there's one more question that happened within that group, and this had to do with treating a hypo. So there was a mother on there, her name was Julie, and she's asked what a good choice to treat a hypo that really doesn't make her son just kind of go running around like a crazy man. So maybe you can share some insight on that as well.
Absolutely. You know, I came across this information in a couple different methods. I practice yoga in the morning. I'm a morning person to the extreme, so I like to do my 6 a.m. yoga. And, you know, every once in a while after, you know, a really great athletic yoga session, I would have a low blood sugar. So I always had juice boxes and glucose tabs. So I'd eat those and then move on with my day. But I noticed on those days that my medication was not working as well. And so I started to just type in, you know, juice and my medication, and I started to realize that there's a bunch of acidic ingredients in a juice box and that they were absolutely cutting my medication in its effectiveness, probably by half. And I didn't know what to do about it. I was like, well, there's nothing I can do. I'm diabetic. I got to eat. I got to drink juice. But I would play around with a number of things, and one is that unless you're severely low and all you can drink is a juice box, you know, and then you're just going to have to say, this is my health, I've got to have a juice.
Right.
But there are a lot of other options, you know, fruit snacks that don't, the kids love them, they're easy to eat, but they have a bunch of a refined sugar, but also citric acid. Orange juice, bunches of citric acid. You know, so I would start to bring a piece of fruit to class in the morning. Bananas, I've noticed, work really well. There's way less potential to kind of mask the medication's effects. Personally, my favorite is dried prunes. I know they look really gross. People don't like them. But they're amazing because you can throw them in your bag and they'll be fine for months. You know,
right. That's
not an issue. I actually put 5 in little snack bags. You know, I do go through a whole pack and just get it over with because it's really gross and my hands get all sticky. So I just do it once. And then I've got a couple months worth of prune packs. But they have fiber in them. So they're going to treat the low, but they're not going to spike you up that fast.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And it gives you something to do when you're low. Because when you're low, your brain is all fuzzy. So you just sit there and chew your prunes. So it works for me. The other thing that I noticed is that I would go on a lot of forums of people who live with ADHD, and they would warn people, don't drink citrus drinks, don't drink lemonade or orange juice. It really ruins the effects of your medication. And I read there that a lot of people, adults especially at work in the afternoon, if they'd had something acidic at lunch, would take a Tums, and that kind of helped rebalance the alkaline environment in your stomach. And I started to think about it, and I said, well, that makes a lot of sense, you know. Right. And so it provides an opportunity for you to get the maximum potential of a medication that you take and to let it do its job all day versus it just getting covered in lots of different things that have a lot of acidic natures in them. And the food that we eat in our culture has, I mean, it's just acidic by nature. So I found that after a low and after I would treat it, that after, you know, I came back to normal, taking a Tums really helped me move on and be able to stay focused.
Very cool. You know, and I love this information. That's something that I had no idea. And my son absolutely loves orange juice. So it's really made me kind of rethink, when is he going to have orange juice during the day?
Right.
Like you, I don't like to deprive him. I still want him to be able to understand that he can eat pretty much anything he wants to and understand the moderation and all of those pieces of the puzzle. But, you know, yeah, that made me totally rethink, how are we going to plan out his day? So
right. Oh, it's amazing. And I have a favorite diet soda. I love it so much, and I will never get it up. I'm a very health-conscious person about nutrition facts, but I'm also a type 1 diabetic. I deserve my diet soda. What I love, though, is a sparkling lemonade. And its first ingredient is citric acid. And I noticed at work when I would drink it around noon with my lunch that I just couldn't get anything done in the afternoon.
That's
so now,
cool.
You know what? It's a treat that I get to have at 5 p.m. when I get home. And it just makes more sense. So I still get to have it, but it's better to wait because it helps me manage my ADHD better.
Absolutely. Now, Asha, before we go, I really want you to talk a little bit about, and you kind of alluded to this, we talked a little bit about your eating disorder, but you also have, you're the founder of We Are Diabetes, and I really would like for you to share a little bit about We Are Diabetes and your role in that.
Sure. You know, and I am always open to talk to anyone listening to this who, you know, thinks that perhaps one of their children or they themselves with type 1 diabetes is struggling from an eating disorder. But after a few years of solid recovery, my husband really kind of pushed me, convinced me to get online and share stories. And I was probably just going to start a blog, but it rapidly grew into the idea of starting a foundation or a company that could help other people get help. So We Are Diabetes is a very special niche, and there's nothing like it out there, really. So we work with a lot of people across the United States, and it helps type 1 diabetics who are suffering from any type of eating disorder get connected to the help and the resources and the support that they need. And we do a lot of that with individual phone calls, but it's very difficult to find the right providers that understand this very special type of eating disorder. So we and Matt and I have done the work of researching and vetting healthcare providers across the United States to be available for those who suffer.
Now, if anybody wants to get in touch with you, I know underneath your name is the website, weardiabetes.org?
It's .org, that's correct.
And then how can they, if they want to talk to you personally, how can they get in touch with you?
We have our emails listed on the contact section of our website, so my other staff members are there as well, but my email is there, and we also have a forum. So if someone is looking for help, but they're not ready to share their real name or individually connect with me, because I will respond to you. I will get really excited about helping you, and you've got to be ready, because recovery doesn't happen until you're ready. Right. So if someone isn't ready, we want those people to know that it's okay. They can just start learning more and seeing what's out there. And then, so we have the forum for that type of community as well.
You know what? I think that's great, because I think recovery comes in steps, and sometimes recovery comes in just peeking out there to see what's out there, and, you know, and taking in that information. So I'm glad that you have a forum with the group as well. And I do want to reiterate that she is very passionate about helping people, and she will find you the people that you need to be in touch with. So, Asha, I want to thank you so much for being on the show today. This video will be posted in Shiny and Sweet. It'll be posted on my Facebook page, which is facebook.com/conversationsincare. And also, I'm sure it's also be on YouTube. So.
Everywhere.
There we go. And also add those recipes as well throughout all those places too. So, Asha, thank you so much for spending some time with me.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Bye.